Magandang araw sa inyong lahat. Oh, dito na naman uli tayo. Hopefully, ako'y nadidinig ninyo. Magandang araw sa inyong lahat. Sandali, iwan ako yung monitor ko. Naka-on. Okay. Binigay ko sa inyo examen, ha? Ano yung examen? Pitong tanong, 7 questions, you answer only 3. Ang submission ay April 12. April 12, Tuesday. Sabi ko 5 p.m. eh, pero pareho na rin siguro yun. 5 p.m. or 12 midnight, pwede na rin. But importante, April 12 ang deadline. Ano pa ang sabi natin? You can compare your answers to the questions with one another. You can consult. Bakit? Paliwanan ko na lang later, ha? Huwag na kayo. May kinalaman sa ating concept of knowledge itself. Hindi naman pwedeng may concept of knowledge tayo pagkatapos hindi natin i-apply doon sa ating practice ng pagtuturo. Ano? Kaya, importante, papayagan ko kayo to compare your answers with one another. Kaya lang, that does not mean you can copy your answers. You have to compose your own answers. You have to compose using your own mental models to make your answer, to, excuse me, to lay down your answers. Yan. Dali nga. Naloko na. May COVID na yata ako. No, ganare. Tingnan muna natin yung inyong sagot saan sa ating mentimeter. Oh, mentimeter. Information theory can be expected to affect everyone's concept of knowledge. Eh, information nga eh. Siyempre, may kilalaman sa knowledge yan. Ano? So, 11 says agree, 1 says disagree. Well, you can disagree. Bakit? Eh, pwede naman information theory can be expected to affect, pero not everyone's concept of knowledge. Kaya naman eh, hindi kayo masyadong pilospo. Tama yung disagree siguro. Epistemologists are generally familiar with the works of Claude Shannon. Sino ba yun? Si Claude Shannon, yung nagtitinda nung taho dun sa Palma Hall dati. Anim agree, pito not sure. Genetic inheritance can be expected to affect everyone's concept of knowledge. 10 agree, 3 not sure, walang nag-disagree. Okay, very good. Epistemologists are generally familiar with the works of Richard Dawkins. 6 agree, 7 not sure, o lamang yung 7. Not sure. I am familiar with the works of Claude Shannon and Richard Dawkins. May dalawa nag-agree, siguro nga. May dalawa hindi sigurado kasi may alam sila pero hindi naman ganun kalalim siguro. Pero 9 say disagree. Ay, wala kaming alam diyan. Akala nga namin nagtitinda ng taho kung saan yan eh. Yan dalawa na yan. Okay. Balik tayo sa akin. Ganito. Pinag-usapan natin yung Duham Quine thesis. Remember, Pierre Duham, who says, no, ano sabi ni Pierre Duham? No scientific knowledge, in other words, no scientific statement or sentence can be taken in isolation of the entire body of science. In other words, every time you look at an hypothesis, that hypothesis should be considered as part and parcel of other related rules of science. Yun ang sinasabi ni Pierre Duham. Sino si Pierre Duham? Physicist. One of the important thermodynamics physicists of the 20th century. Ngayon, sino si Willard Van Orman Quine? Si Quine, beginning the 1950s, was the chairman of the philosophy department of Harvard University at that time. center of research in philosophy. Ano sabi ni Richard ni Quine? Ganun din. No scientific statement can be taken in isolation. Ergo, the concept of holism in epistemology. Yan. Ah, tingin tayo din eh. Sino yung sinabi natin? Chairman ng Philosophy Department ng Harvard University. Sino yan? Si Willard Van Orman Quine. Yung litrato na yan ay with the permission of his son, ginagamit natin. Yung anak niya, profesor na rin. Yung profesor na yon ay yun ang nagbigay ng litrato na yan. So, ngayon, anong sabi ni Quine at saka ni Duham? Duham, Quine thesis. No scientific statement can be taken in isolation. Itong sinasabi nitong dalawa na ito, sino? Si Pierre Duham, the physicist at Quine. Exactly, this is the rule involved. Ngayon, anong problema? Si Pierre Duham, physicist. Yung kanya isinulat noong 1906, eh siyempre, ang nakabasa mga physicist. Yung mga pilosopo, nabasa lang yan sinulat niya later on about right after the Second World War. So, walang masyadong epekto sa philosophy. Independent of Pierre Duham, Willard Van Orman Quine, sinabi niya rin ito noong 1950s. And in fact, it was in the 1950s that finally, nakita nila na tama si Pierre Duham na unpang kay Quine. Ergo, the assumption that viewing science as a body should be considered always as a whole. Ergo, holism. Holism as a school of thought in epistemology. Sino nagpauso niyan? Ay di si Quine. Yun nga. Ay, sabulo ko naman mag-type. Yan. Sino nagpauso nito? Ito na nga si Quine. Yan. Now, pinag-usapan na natin yan earlier. So, hindi ko na masyadong babalikan. Ano? Although, pinakita dyan yung limits of science and reasoning. Lamang dun sa Duham Quine thesis, alam na natin may limitasyon ang science at saka reasoning. Bakit? Kasi if you have some hypothesis H out of which you derive a prediction, what we usually do is we try to produce the prediction under laboratory conditions, and therefore, once that is done, we conclude the hypothesis is correct. This is, of course, a fallacy. This is affirming the consequent fallacy. And of course, that tells you may limits ang scientific method. Now, we also try to do it this way, in the affirmative way. From some hypothesis, we try to derive some prediction. Now, when the negation of the prediction happens, then we say we can now negate the hypothesis. The Duham-Quine thesis says this cannot be done. Why? Because your hypothesis is always to be considered in relation to other corollary hypotheses. Meaning to say, you cannot take your hypothesis in isolation of your other hypothesis within your same body of science. So what happens is you really do it this way, from hypothesis together with your system, that's where you derive your prediction. Now, when the prediction does not happen, then you say there is something wrong with your hypothesis together with your system, where your system is, of course, your conjunction of all your statements in science. And so what happens, you can conclude either something is wrong with your hypothesis or something is wrong with your system, which means you're actually saying either there is something wrong with your hypothesis or one part of your system or another part of your system or another part of your system. And life goes on as science expands. And that tells you, even when you're using this kind of schema, there will be limits to your reasoning, same with here. So, yan ay salamat sa duhang kwintesis. Ngayon, lumalabas na you have to look at knowledge, at least knowledge in science, as a system. You have to look at knowledge or science as a knowledge, a body of knowledge as a system. Diyan pumapasok yung systems analysis. And when you have to deal with systems analysis, you have to deal with mathematical logic. So, in the case of Quine, he was very much involved with systems analysis, ergo mathematical logic, ergo science. So, sabi ni Quine, science itself, in other words, using the techniques of science as applied to epistemology. As applied to epistemology. Yun ang nangyari kay Quine. Especially, yung isang kapareho ng sinasabi niya ay scientist, si Pierre Duhem. Now, this has led Quine to conclude, maybe we're doing epistemology in the wrong direction. We're practicing epistemology in the wrong direction. Yun ang sinasabi. So, sabi ni Quine, wrong direction. Wrong direction, says Quine. Eh, kung wrong direction, ano yung tamang direction? Sabi ni Quine, dapat ang tamang direction yung naturalized epistemology. Yan. Yung naturalized epistemology, ano ba yan, Lintris na yan? Okay. Yung naturalized epistemology is actually the practice of epistemology using the techniques of science. Yan. Okay. So, 1950s, na-involve si Quine sa systems analysis of knowledge. Not only knowledge, knowledge in terms of scientific knowledge, but knowledge at large because philosophy professor siya. And then he of course, teaches epistemology. And sa pagtuturo niya ng epistemology, sinasabi niya, we cannot do epistemology independent of scientific practice, precisely because this is the age of space exploration. This is the age of science. So yun ang dating. Pagdating na 1960s, dineclare na niya, literally, as in, he says it in his lectures and in his books, that we have to reinvent, let me repeat, we have to reinvent. Maligayang araw, Miss Ambier. Buti na lang, nandiyan uli. So sabi ni Quine, we have to reinvent 1960s. Ha? Sabi niya, we have to reinvent the practice of epistemology in philosophy. We must involve ourselves with the techniques of science, especially when we are dealing with systems analysis of knowledge. Yan. Okay. So, ano ngayon? Okay. Ito nangyari. So, sikat na sikat si ano, ha? Si Quine for that reason. Because, you know, after thousands of years, all of a sudden, we need to take a second look at epistemology. Ay, teka, ba't nawala yung aking screen sharing? Yun. Okay. Let me repeat. After thousands of years, all of a sudden, here is someone saying we need to reinvent our concept of epistemology. We need to reinvent the way we practice epistemology or rethink how we practice epistemology. Yan si Quine. At of course, sabi ko nga kanina, pang pinagmulan niyan eh, yung kanyang yung tinatawag nating Duham Quine thesis. Babalikan natin yan, but ito yung importante. Ito ngayon si Quine. Sikat na sikat for saying we need to reinvent epistemology. Ngayon, ito naman si Claude Shannon. Eh, bakit importante rin si Claude Shannon? Ganun rin nangyari. No, it is a photograph by Conrad Jacobs. Actually, Conrad Jacobs has a foundation, and that foundation has made it public, this photograph. Okay. Now, sino si Claude Shannon? Siya yung tinatawag nating father of information theory. Mas kilala siya dyan. Pero sa totoo lang, siya ang umimbento noong 1930s. Siya ang umimbento noong 1930s ng circuit boards. Master's degree thesis niya. Without circuit boards, of course, literally, you cannot have computers as we know them. So, circuit, ay mali, boards. Ang invento niya, ano? Ay, talaga naman. Mali yung spelling ko. Yan. Okay. In other words, in a manner of speaking, dahil sa circuit boards, na-invento ang computers. But beyond that, he is known as the father of information theory. Now, what is information theory? Put it this way. Entropy. Second law of thermodynamics. Ang umimbento niyan ay sino? Ang nag-lay down ng rule na yan ay sino? Si Clausius. Sali ha, nakalimutan ko ng first name ni Clausius. Rudolf Clausius. Rudolf Clausius. He first formulated the second law of thermodynamics in terms of physics. Physics. Nasaan na ba yung nilagay ko? Hindi ha. Si Rudolf Clausius, siya yung umimbento ng unang-unang formulation ng law of entropy. Kaya hinahanap ko yung equation niya. Dali lang po. Ito yung theorem niya eh. Anyway, just take my word for it. Dali ha. Sandali lang po. Etong formulation ng entropy na ito ni Clausius, huwag na nating pag-usapan ng details, is in terms of energy in relation to energy in relation to temperature. So, physics, energy in relation to temperature, or in relation to change in temperature. Okay. Ngayon, yung second law of thermodynamics na ginawa ni Rudolf Clausius ay nagkaroon ng pagbabago. Dito pumasok si Boltzmann. Yan. Kilala niyo si Boltzmann. Si Ludwig Boltzmann. Okay. Si Ludwig Boltzmann. Ano yun? Dito pumasok si Ludwig Boltzmann. Si Ludwig Boltzmann, ininterpret niya ang second law of thermodynamics in terms of chemistry. Paano nangyari? Kasi ang kanyang paliwanag sa entropy ay hindi in terms of energy in relation to temperature. Ang paliwanag ni Ludwig Boltzmann ang paliwanag ni Ludwig Boltzmann ay more in terms of statistics and of course the atomic theory that was becoming popular in his time sa chemistry. ito ang kanyang equation. See, you don't see their temperature as a factor. Okay, you don't see temperature as a factor. Dito, yung paliwanag ng entropy, ng behavior ng entropy is in terms of relationship between energy and temperature. Dito, this is statistical. In other words, statistical in relation to atoms, number of atoms. In other words, in relation to atomic theory in chemistry. Now remember, what is Western civilization all about? Western civilization is all about prediction. Science is all about prediction. And what's the point? Looks like the formulation of Boltzmann here in terms of prediction is more reliable. So, sabi nila, ito na lang gamitin natin. And so, yung kay Clausius na formulation, pinalitan nito. Okay. Mas reliable. Pero one of the effects of doing this is the disintegration of boundary between physics and chemistry. Okay, we're talking here about the 1800s. In the 1800s, yung pagkakaiba ng physics sa chemistry nawala na. By saying, you know, this kind of interpretation is still related to this kind of interpretation, you're saying physics and chemistry are actually one and the same. When you do physics, you do chemistry. When you do chemistry, you do physics. Yun. Ngayon, saan pumasok naman si Claude Shannon? Ito na ngayon. Dito pumasok si Claude Shannon. Bakit? Sabi ni Claude Shannon, in the 1940s, remember, by that time, sikat na siya. Dahil yung kanyang invention ng circuit boards ay revolutionized technology in so many ways, and more importantly, revolutionized what we call now digital computers. Paved the way for digital computers. No 1930s, pero 1940s, sikat siya more for information theory. Bakit kamo information theory? It's about information. Now, this is the point. Si Claude Shannon, nasan na yun? Yung si Claude Shannon, okay, tingnan natin ito ha. Dali lang, ay, shush ko. Ito naman ito. Dali ha, Shannon equation na lang tayo. Shannon entropy equation. sinasabi ni Claude Shannon with this equation, we don't have to look into the details, ano? Sinasabi ni Claude Shannon with this equation, inspired by Ludwig Boltzmann's interpretation of entropy. Sinasabi niya, information is governed by the by entropy. In other words, the mathematical formulation, ng second law of thermodynamics as espoused by Boltzmann can be applied to information. Punta tayo sa akin. Ms. Javier, nasusundan pa ang usapan?
Opo, nasusundan po.
Oo, oh, ganare. Si Claude Shannon, dahil na-invento nga na yung lintik na circuit board as we know it, kinuha ng Bell Laboratories, Bell Labs. Yung si Alexander Graham Bell, remember, siya yung umimbento ng telepono. And one of the outputs ng kanyang research ay nagtayo ng Bell Laboratories as a corporation. And by the 1940s, Bell Laboratories was the biggest research and development companies in the whole world. Bakit? Kasi lahat ng tao sa mundo nagamit ng telepono. Lahat ng tao sa mundo nagpapagalingan sa paggawa ng telepono. Merong malaking research and development section yung Bell Corporation, and that is called Bell Laboratories. Si Claude Shannon, kinuha ng Bell Laboratories. And ang malaki nilang problema, remember, nagsisimula na ang telepono kukonekta na from the United States to Japan, from the United States to the Philippines, across the world. And maraming technical difficulties ang involved. And yung technical difficulties, pag ginamitan ng systems analysis, will involve mathematics and mathematical logic. Now, dyan mahusay si Claude Shannon. Mahusay siya sa mathematical logic, kaya nga niya na-invento yung circuit board, at mahusay din siya sa mathematics per se. And given his knowledge of mathematics and mathematical logic and familiarity with science, naisip-isipan niya na yung second law of thermodynamics ay apply sa mga technical problems ng Bell Laboratories and therefore Bell Corporation. Ano nangyari? Ito na nga ang resulta, Ms. Javier. Na-invento niya yung formulation ng law of entropy in the form of information theory, which goes to show that yung mundo ng physics at mundo ng chemistry ay hindi malayo sa mundo ng information. Dati-dati, merong boundary yan eh. Dati-dati, merong boundary. Boundary between chemistry and information. Yung nangyayari sa mga molecules and atoms ay walang kinalaman sa ating concept of knowledge. Pero, lumalabas with information theory na yung mundo ng physics at chemistry ay hindi malayo sa mundo na information. Another way of putting it is, yung mundo ng cyberspace At mundo ng cyberspace at mundo ng physical natural space. Ay hindi malayo sa mundo ng cyberspace. Ulitin natin, ang mundo ng physical natural space na dati-dating may boundary, salamat dito sa information theory, ay nawala na ng distinction. Saka ako may papaliwanag later yan, but very dramatic yung epekto. Parang, totoo ba yan? But for the moment, let's just say, yung mundo ng physics at chemistry na halo sa mundo ng information. Yan. Ay isang halimbawa yan ang sinasabi ni Quine. Na ano, remember, sabi ni Quine, naturalized epistemology. Isang halimbawa yan na yung konsepto natin ng epistemology baka dapat ay gawin natin compatible sa konsepto natin ng science. Yung concept natin ng knowledge, gawin natin knowledge in terms of our studies in epistemology dapat compatible with our knowledge of what science is all about. Yan. Ngayon, punta muna tayo kay Richard Dawkins. So, ito, parang ibang klase, no? Yung meeting natin, ha? Yung dating mundo ng information, hiwalay sa mundo ng physics and chemistry. Salamat dun sa information theory equation ni Claude Shannon, nawala na yung distinction. Another way of putting it, yung mundo ng cyberspace na dating nakikita nating hiwalay sa mundo ng physical natural space, ay nagsama na. Ergo, proof for what Quine has pointed out earlier, the need for what we now call a naturalized epistemology, a new approach to epistemology. Yan. Ay, nawala. Ayaw mo. Sandali, ha? Okay. So, balikan natin si Richard Dawkins. Ay, nasa na ba yun? Gwapong-gwapo nitong mama na ito, eh. Ito. Tago muna natin to si Quine. Tago muna natin to si Claude Shannon. Okay, dyan muna kayo sa isang tabi. Tago rin natin ito. Okay. Ang dali ah, sorry. Makakailanganin natin mamaya eh. Father of information theory. Okay, ito. Richard Dawkins. Sino si Richard Dawkins? Biologist. Biologist from Oxford. Richard Dawkins. That's him. A biologist from Oxford. Photo taken by Mike Cornwell. Oxford University. Saan niya nanggaling yung word meme? He actually invented the word meme. Yan. But before we even talk about the word meme, we must talk about biology. And as we talk about biology, of course, we have no choice but to talk about the greatest biologist of all time, si Charles Darwin. Ano ang sinasabi ni Charles Darwin? Living organisms are products of evolution. Now, what is evolution? Okay, sino may sabi niyan? Si Charles Darwin. What is evolution? Evolution involves natural selection. Natural selection means competition. Natural selection means competition between organisms and individual and species of organisms. And competition means some will lose, some will win. Or better yet, some will win, some will lose. And in other words, some become extinct, some survive, some become extinct. In other words, biology is all about survival. In fact, the study of biology is the study of how, given their own strategies, or certain organisms have survived. So it's all about survival. Kung kinalaman niya sa knowledge, balikan natin later. Miss Javier, nasusundan pa ka?
Opo, medyo po.
Oh, ganun eh. Meron si Charles Darwin, napaliwanag ko. Si Charles Darwin, meron siyang problem. Why? Because if natural selection is the rule, then how do we explain altruism? Now, what is altruism? Well, put it this way. If natural selection is the rule, excuse me, then selfishness rules. Which is why, by the way, why natural selection has become very popular with big business, because big business always works with what is to their advantage. And big business like the corporations of the United Kingdom, the British Empire, and corporations of America, and corporations of Europe, that's what they always tell everyone. This is but natural in this universe that there is always natural selection and selfishness rules. Because that's the only way you will survive. Because you either win or lose. That's Darwin's problem. Why is it a problem? Because there is evidence there is much evidence for selflessness among humans and even among animals. Yan. Okay. So, remember, salamat kay Pythagoras. Ang pamimilosopo has always involved coherence, has always involved identification of pain points we now call contradictions, or baliktad, has always involved contradictions we now call pain points. You look at a system, you look for whether how the system is coherent and not coherent. It is coherent when there are less contradictions and therefore, by definition, more coherence. When there are more contradictions, therefore, less coherence. And what's the contradiction? You're saying in the natural world, the rule is natural selection. The rule is selfishness. So why are there, if selfishness is natural, why are there occasions of selflessness among humans? We even see humans sacrificing themselves, dying for others, like Ninoy Aquino, or Bongbong Marcos. Balik tayo sa usapan. And even among animals, Ms. Javier, there are examples of altruism. Altruism, ano ba ang ibig sabihin ng altruism? O share nga natin. Yung kasarap ng gumamit ng Wikipedia. Bakit? Kapag may tanong kayo, tatanong mo lang, altruism. Ano ang ibig sabihin ng altruism? Yan! O altruism, sometimes called otherism. Yan. Altruism is the principle and moral practice of concern for happiness of other human beings or other animals. If you are selfless, if you are selfish, you are only concerned with yourself. But there is much evidence that altruism, which is what? What is altruism? Is that principle and moral practice of concern for happiness of other human beings and other animals. There is much evidence for this. Halimbawa, mga bees or ants, social animals. Yung bee, meron silang queen bee. Meron silang soldier ants, soldier bees, at meron silang worker bees. Meron silang drone. Yung drone, meron siyang genetic inheritance. Yung queen bee, meron siyang genetic inheritance. Yung workers and soldiers, meron silang genetic inheritance. But what's the point? First, let's look at soldiers. When soldier bees sting with their stingers remain with the victim. Halimbawa, tinamaan kayo ng bini sa leg ng sting ng bee, yung bee lilipad. Pag lumipad yung bee, maiwan yung stinger. Pag naiwan yung stinger, yung bee magkaka-injury, mamamatay yun. Soldier bees get to sacrifice themselves for the sake of their beehive. We see that all the time. Worker bees do the same. They sacrifice themselves for the sake of the beehive. Altruism. How do you explain that? Okay. So, may mga pumasok na nagpaliwanag. Ang paliwanag sa Darwin's problem about altruism. Anong sagot? Yan. Anong sagot? Okay. Answer to Darwin's problem about altruism. Kaya pangyan muna na, tingnan muna natin to. Paradox of altruism. paradoxe. Ay, kaba, katang, sandali ha, ang tagal eh. Anyway, huwag na nating puntahan ng detalye, baka masyado kami maraming na ano eh. Ang sagot has to do with selfish genes. Selfish genes. In other words, it is not, ang sagot eh, it is not the individuals that matter in competition. Kasi ganito, anong sabi natin? Sa biology, natural selection is the rule. Now, selfishness rules. Pero may problem ka ng altruism. Now, ang sinasabi natin, when you talk of survival, it is not survival of the individual that you should deal with. So, yun ang sinasabi. It is not the individuals that matter when there is competition. It is the heritage or the genes, the hereditary elements, the heredity. It is the heredity that matter. It is the genes that matter. In other words, genes, in a manner speaking, are selfish. They try to protect themselves. They want to survive. Survival of genes ang usapan, hindi survival of individual. So, balik tayo sa akin, Ms. Javier. Ang nangyayari, sinasabi ng mga biologists, including mga followers ni Charles Darwin, ang nangyayari, sinasabi nila na it is the genes that actually matter for survival, it's not the individual, excuse me. So, more importantly, why do soldier bees try to protect the beehive? It's not because of himself. The soldier bees try to protect the beehive because he wants to protect the genetic material in the drones and in the bee queen. So yung queen at saka yung drone may genetic material, they're the ones who reproduce for everyone, reproducing worker bees, reproducing soldier bees. And when the soldier bees try kill themselves kill themselves to protect the beehive, they're actually expressing the selfishness of the genes of the beehive. Yan. They're actually expressing the selfishness of the genes of the beehive. So yun ang sagot. Yan. Now, in the process of dealing with the nature of selfish genes, Richard Dawkins in 1976, in his book, Selfish Genes. What's the title of the book? Selfish Genes. Kailan to? 1976. Inintroduce ni Richard Dawkins yung word memes. Inintroduce ni Richard Dawkins yung... Oh, hindi naka-share.
Opo.
Naloko na. Oh, gano'n rin. Balik tayo sa sinabi ko, ano? So, anong sagot? Yung sagot doon sa Darwin's problem, it is not the survival of the individuals that matter. It is the heredity that matters. It is the heredity that matters, meaning to say the genes are the ones that need to survive. Yun ang sinasabi natin. At dyan, talking about heredity and genetic material and their survival, dyan pumasok si Richard Dawkins. Kasi nung 1976, gumawa siya ng libro, Selfish Genes. At doon sa libro na yan, doon niya na-introduce yung word memes. Ngayon, sikat na sikat sa inyo. Okay. Now, related yan sa word culture. So, let's put it this way. Yung mga Inuits, meron kanilang culture. Sa culture nila, sino Inuits? Yung mga nakatira sa Alaska, nakatira sa Alaska, nakatira sa Greenland, they have more than, meron silang language. And with their language, they have more than 200 ways of pointing to snow. There are 200 kinds of snow, something like that. Given our culture in the Philippines, therefore given our language, we have only such limited ways of pointing to snow. Now, there are cultures all over the world. Now, let's talk about phenotype. Phenotype is the kind of characteristic, physical characteristic, or property of an organism. Halimbawa, ano ang phenotype ng humans? Ang phenotype ng humans, lahat sila may dalawang mata. Ano pa? Lahat sila may brain na... Anong brain ng humans? Ang brain ng humans ay something like 16,000 cubic centimeters. Okay. So may phenotype tayo, our physical properties as humans. How do you know you're a human? Well, you have a big brain of around 1,600 cubic centimeters. That's very clear among humans. Malaking brain nila. Ano pa? Very clear among humans, we walk upright. Ergo, we have this kind of legs. Yun yung phenotype natin. We have legs that help us stand upright. Therefore, we have hips of such design. Yun yung phenotype natin. Yung design ng hips natin. Yun yung design ng legs natin. So, we walk upright. Now, when you talk of genotype, that literally means the kind of genetic encoding such that when you grow up, you will have legs like this. Genotype, the kind of encoding in your genes such that you will have brains like that as you grow up. Yeah. So biologists talk all the time about genotypes and phenotypes. Now, ito yung ginawa ni Richard Dawkins. You see, phenotypes, according to Richard Dawkins, are not limited only to the physical characteristic or properties of organism. Phenotypes in terms of humans and even animals can be in the form of culture or body of knowledge. Culture. Now, what is culture? Culture is some technique or process of transferring knowledge, transferring and using knowledge. Now, may kanyang technique at process ng transferring and using knowledge yung mga Inuits, ergo, they end up with their own kind of language. Same with us, ergo, we end up with our own kind of language, and therefore our own culture. But whether you agree with this or not, The point is, whether you agree with this or not, the point is, culture is extension of the concept of phenotype. In other words, culture is as much a phenotype as your legs or your brain. Your physical characteristic indicates you're a human. Your culture indicates you're a human. Yun ang sinasabi ni Richard Dawkins, which is very strange to start with, but since 1976 has become very popular. Now, while in terms of your phenotype, your physical characteristics are dependent on your genes, let me repeat, your physical characteristics are dependent on your genes. Similarly, your culture, which is your extension of your phenotype, is itself dependent on what Richard Dawkins called memes. And so when you talk of phenotypes that make us humans, meron tayong physical characteristic, but meron tayong extension ng characteristics natin because they are still dependent on our physical characteristics, but they are extensions of our phenotypes. Yung culture natin make us human, define us as humans, and the way we transfer physical properties or characteristics as organisms, we transfer via genes. The way we transfer culture via our memes. So, meron tinatawag tayong genes, meron tayong tinatawag na memes. So, definition of a meme, here it is. What is a meme? Based on the work ni Richard Dawkins, what is a meme? This is what a meme is. Sandali, ha? This is what a meme is. A meme is an element of culture or system of behavior. A meme is an element of culture or a system of behavior passed from one individual to another by imitation or other non-genetic means. Now, let me repeat. Element of a culture or system of behavior passed on from one individual to another by imitation or other non-genetic means. Excuse me. Sino yung nagsabi niyan? Si Claude Shannon. Ah, sorry. Sino yung nagsabi niyan? Si Richard Dawkins. So here we are. Richard Dawkins.
Sir?
Oh, wala na naman.
Meron po. Pero may tanong po sa stream.
Okay, sige. Go.
Ayun po. Sir, kay Juan Heredia po.
Ano?
Yung kay Juan po. How do we, Juan Heredia po, how do we know that that's the reason for bees protecting their beehive? I think, sir, this is referring to the selfish genes po.
Nga, no, hindi ko nakita. Mr. Heredia, bahala ka sa buhay mo. Ganito, yung panahon ni Charles Darwin, tinatanong din yan eh. Merong isang sumagot, sabi niya, And this is his name. Okay, Mr. Reja. Salamat, Ms. Javier. Mr. Reja, ito yung sagot. Sabi ni Peter Kropotkin. Excuse me. Grabe, ha? Baka ako'y may COVID na. Miss Javier, nabasa mo?
So, hindi po.
Ito. Mr. Reja, sabi ni Peter Kropotkin, may maling ari yan sa sagot na iyan. ganito, ano? Unfortunately for Kropotkin, si Kropotkin ay contemporary ni Charles Darwin. Mas bata lang ng konti. After a while, namatay na si Charles Darwin, hindi na niya nasagot yung problem niya. Nagpatuloy ng buhay si Kropotkin, in fact, all the way to the 20th century. Kasi tumanda siya nang matanda. And ari ang nangyari, Miss Ahing, perhaps, sabi ni Miss Ahing, perhaps via some kind of genetic instinct. Ganito, Miss Ahing, Mr. Heredia. unfortunately for Kropotkin and fortunately for Charles Darwin, ito ang nangyari. Papaliwanag ko later. Ang nangyari, yung Darwinian theory nabigyan ng mathematical explanation. Okay. Natural selection based on the concept of selfish genes has been reformulated in mathematical terms. Yun ang malupit. Ito ang nangyari. Alam nyo naman sa science, 20th century, ano ba yan? Alam nyo naman sa science, 20th century science, importante ang mathematics. And unfortunately, yung Kropotkin's view never mathematicized. So dahil hindi na mathematicize, hindi siya sumikat . Walang nakinig. Walang naniwala. Now, excuse me. Mr. Reja, ang nangyari? Mr. Reja, ang nangyari? Miss Ahing, ang nangyari? Simple lang ang tanong . Sabi nila ng 20th century. Basta i-apply natin at kung mas mahusay magamit for prediction, the better. And from their point of view, nung na-mathematicize yung Darwinian theory with the assumption of the concept of selfish genes, mukhang papunta doon ang direksyon ng application. And so, ang tanong how do we know that the reason for bees protecting their beehive? Data. And data, collect data using mathematical analysis. Yun lang ang tanong. How do you answer? Data. Data will tell you that's the reason. Why? Because if you use the mathematical form of Darwinian theory, you can predict. Huwag na nating puntahan yung details, ano? But you can predict. And once you can predict, that answers your question. Oh, tama yung assumption. The hypothesis, the assumption now becomes a theory, now becomes a rule that we will apply. Why? We already believe it because we have data to back up our claim. Yun lang ang sagot, Mr. Heredia. Yun lang ang sagot, Ms. Javier. Nasundan, Ms. Javier, yung sinabi ko?
Opo, super gets.
May problema yan, ha? Masyadong believe din ng mga scientists sa sarili nila. Ipapakita natin ba't importante tayo mga pilosopo eh. Pero at the end of the semester na lang. Ganito, balik tayo sa usapan natin. Maganda yung tanong niya, no? Ni Mr. Heredia, at ito nga ang sinasabi natin. 20th century science, kung kailan sinasabi mathematics rules, yung view ni Kropotkin na hindi na mathematicize, walang masyadong makaintindi. Dahil yung natural selection based on the concept of selfish genes, sumikat. Isa na nga dun sa mga believers, si Richard Dawkins. Yan. Pero, meron pero. Richard Dawkins, in the process of talking about selfish genes, brought up the idea that phenotypes do not only come in the form of physical properties. Phenotypes come in the form of culture. So, our capacity to wield language is a phenotype of the human. Okay. Ms. Javier, ganito yung dating, ano? Nouna, how do you know you're humans? Well, because we have our specific design of our hips so that we get to have a specific design of our legs, femur and our legs. And therefore, we are able to walk upright and therefore, in the process, we're able to have bigger brains and therefore, in the process, we get to have language. Our capacity to wield language, by the way, I can show you that but not now. Na yung capacity natin to wield language has so much to do with our design of our hips. Ganun rin nangyari niyan, eh. Dahil may design tayo ng hips natin, nagkaroon tayo ng ganitong femur. Magkaroon tayo ng ganitong femur at saka legs, nakalakad tayo upright. Nakalakad tayo upright, lumaki yung ating brain. Lumaki yung ating brain at the same time, therefore, lumiit yung ating throat, nawala ng muscles. Nung nawala ng muscles, nagkaroon tayo ng voice box na maayos. Nung nagkaroon ng voice box na maayos, nagkaroon tayo ng language. And language, you might say, is now an extension of our phenotype ng ating hips. Dahil nagka-hips tayo, nagka-femur tayo, nagka-legs tayo, mag-ganito, nagka-legs tayo ganito, lumaki yung brain natin, hindi na natin kailangan ng muscles na masyado. Hindi kailangan muscles na masyado, gumanda ang throat natin, nagkaroon tayo ng language. And then with our language, nagkaroon tayo ng culture, later civilization. Our capacity to wield language is an indicator of being human, Homo sapiens sapiens, with the 23 alleles. 23 alleles or pairs of chromosomes, tama. Yung ating capacity to wield language is as good an indicator as our physical property that we are humans. Yun ang sinasabi ni Richard Dawkins. But guess what? Then he needs to reinvent how do we transfer memes? Kasi iba yung meme ng mga Inuits, iba yung meme ng mga Pilipino, yung mga Inuits. They have 200 ways of calling snow. Mga Pilipino, tatatlo laang. Ay, hindi genetic yan. Kasi kung genetic, pareho lang. Sabi ni Richard Dawkins, hindi genetic, yan ay memetic. Yan. Transfer of our culture is memetic. Ergo, the expression memes. And then natapos na dyan ang usapan ni Richard Dawkins. Okay, so keep it in mind. Okay, humans, the Homo sapiens sapiens.
So, hindi po naka-share.
Ay, talaga naman. Gutom na ako, kaya ganyan. Ganun eh. Yung Homo sapiens sapiens, how do we know Homo sapiens sapiens? Well, because of his genes. First, we don't look at the genes, we look at the phenotype. Physical phenotype. And yung physical phenotype, ano yung indicators niyan? Meron siyang big brain. Ano yun? 1600 cubic centimeters, more or less. Ano pa? Meron siyang specific design of, ano, of hips and legs. So upright. Upright. Upright legs. Posture. Hindi pala. Sorry. Ano yung physical? We have our design of our hips and legs. Very unique sa atin yan. But anyway, physical phenotype. But meron din tayong extended phenotype. Gaya ng ano, language. And much as all of these are dependent on genes, in other words, physical phenotype or big brain or design of hips, dependent on our genes, ganun din yung ating extended phenotype dependent on our memes. Yeah. Genes dependent on our memes. Ano pang example natin extended phenotype? Language is one. Our concept of art is another. Una natin sabihin concept of art. Art is another. And so on and so forth. So, dalawang example, ano? And dito nagkakaroon ng problema. Bakit? Nagkakaroon ng problema kasi may proof tayo ng genes. Genes are observable and physical. They are observable and physical. We already know that. Bakit? With the discovery of our DNA, our diribonucleic acid. So, ang tanong, ay, what about memes? Ang marami nagsasabi, haka-haka lang to. Bakit Ms. Javier, haka-haka lang? Kasi since 1976, hindi natin makita kung nasan yung memes. No physical evidence for memes. Kaya noong year 2005, yung Journal for Memetics, nag-shutdown na. Yan. An indicator that in the world of the academics, at least, mukhang analogical lamang. It's just an analogy. There is no science in it. So yan, ha? Parang ganun ang sinasabi. Dahil walang physical evidence, you see, it has to be physical. In other words, kaya dapat observable, physical eh. Therefore, non-science ang memetics. Okay? Non-science ang memetics. Okay. Balik tayo sa akin. Eh, paano kung may proof ng memes? Physical proof. What are these memes? Mababagong usapan. And I'm telling you, it's physical. I'll show you, but I will deal with that later. So, Ms. Javier, all of a sudden, mababagong usapan. Dahil naging physical ang memes, then we can now deal with it in scientific ways. Now, if we deal with it in scientific ways, then what does that mean? That means we have to take memetics seriously. Now, when we take memetics seriously, ano implication yan sa concept of knowledge? Malaki. Even better, Ms. Javier, when now we are able to say what memes are in terms of physical natural space, then we're also able to say that we can mathematicize it. Mathematicize what? Yung sinasabi ni Kropotkin. Yung sinasabi ni Kropotkin ay merong mathematical form. And the mathematical form of, na sinasabi ni Kropotkin ay related dun sa Shannon's law. Yung equation ni Shannon, ma-apply natin sa memetics. Pag na-apply natin ang equation ni Shannon sa memetics, magkakaroon ng paliwanag and therefore capacity to predict ang sinasabi ni Kropotkin in terms of altruism. Because Kropotkin was a defender of altruism. That altruism, according to Kropotkin, is natural. And there is now a mathematical proof for it. And thanks to that mathematical proof, Shannon's law, we can predict better. Yan. Exciting, di ba? So, pag pinaghalo nyo yung Shannon's law sa pag-aaral ng biology, all of a sudden, altruism becomes understandable. Not in terms of religion, but in terms of science. And guess what? Ang implication, malaking kinalaman din dun sa concept of knowledge. Sa ngayon, ang masasabi ko pa lang sa inyo, eh ganito. Ulitin natin. Kapag naipakita natin yung physical form ng memes, then mamamathematicize natin. Pag namathematicize natin, then mapapatunayan natin yung altruism na pinapaliwanag ni Kropotkin. At pag naipaliwanag natin yan, maraming implication yan sa biology. Maraming implication yan sa understanding of civilization and culture. But also, because it has to do with understanding of civilization and culture, then may kinalaman sa knowledge, whether we like it or not. Yan. At bottom line is, ang masasabi ko sa inyo, Ms. Ahing, Mr. Heredia, and Ms. Esparago, and Ms. Javier, ang masasabi ko lang sa inyo ay, unfortunately, hindi lahat na nag-aaral ng epistemology, hindi lahat na nag-aaral ng philosophy are into this. Bakit? Eh kasi unang-una, kagaya ninyo, kayo ay may aversion sa pagkuha ng vertebrate anatomy. Kaya ang vertebrate anatomy, hindi lang sa napakahirap, ay napakababa pang magbigay ng grade ng mga teacher diyan. 5-unit subject. Ay kukuha rin kayo ng statistics. Eh pag kumuha kayo ng statistics, para nga maintindihan ninyo hindi na statistics, calculus. Calculus and statistics. Pag gumawa kayo ng calculus and statistics, kailangan yan para maintindihan nyo yung mga equations ni Boltzmann at equations ni Shannon. Ay pag kumuha kayo ng calculus and statistics, 4-unit subject yan eh. Eh ngayon, ano nangyari? Ang ating mga teacher, walang nagtuturo ng epistemology, walang nagtuturo ng philosophy in relation to what Quine demands. Quine demands to naturalize epistemology. Yan ngayon ang problema natin. Kaya hindi ko kayo basta mabigyan ng readings na mag-i-extend ng ating usapan. Pero susubukan natin next meeting. Next meeting ha, kasi after today, magbabakasyon na tayo. Tama ba ga, Ms. Javier? After today, bakasyon na tayo?
Opo.
Hanggang kailan? Hanggang 12?
Ah, hindi po. Hanggang Easter po. So, 18.
Opo. Ah, 18 ga? 18. Allah, ay siya. Mali ang aking basa. Kahirap ng duling. Hanggang 18, wala tayong klase.
Opo.
Naloko na ay garne. Everybody, listen. Kailan ang first day of classes natin after Holy Week?
18 po. So, for us, 19.
Submissions of answers to first exam is now 19. 19 April. Baka naman kayo niloloko mo ha, Miss Javier.
Hindi po. Sana naman hindi.
19 April 2022. So, yun na yung effective ano ha. Submissions of answers to first exam is now 19 April 2022. Ha? Okay?
Sige po.
Pero, kaya ngayon, maintindihan ninyo, hindi ko rin basta ma-extend yung ating syllabus kasi kailangan maintindihan ko muna kung may nakahabol sa inyo at kung may capability tayo as a class to go into the matters that I'm talking about. But intuitively, you already know. Intuitively, you already know. Ano yung sagot ninyo kanina? Sorry ha, extend tayo ng konti. Intuitively, you already know that genetic inheritance will have something to do with our concept of knowledge. Sampo nga sumabi, nagsabi sa inyo eh. Intuitively, you know that information theory may epekto sa ating concept of knowledge. And yan ang papasukan natin. So, maligayang araw po. Ingat lagi. Happy bakasyon. Pero happy bunurin sa inyong mga readings. Bubunuin yung mga readings nating iba eh. Ingat lagi. Bye-bye.